Amen. Amen. Matthew 18:20 says, where two or three are gathered together in his name, he's in the midst. So my wife said, look, don't worry about the numbers. You worry about if Jesus is here. That's what's most important. So thank God for that reminder. It's about Jesus. It's not about us. Amen. 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 Thank God for another day and thank him for this opportunity. It's a humbling experience, to say the least. Too many people want to be up here because they have something to say. And that's the problem. They have something to say. They're not saying what God said. So I don't have anything to say. I have to say what God told me to say. Say it and sit down and shut up. Amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, turn to Psalm 107, verse 2. Psalm 107, verse 2. Psalms 107 verse 2 says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. So how many of us here have been redeemed from the hand of the enemy? Amen. So I know it's Independence weekend, and actually I did not sit down and say I'm going to do an Independence Day message. That thought never crossed my mind. We were at radio station yesterday, and Pastor made mention of the fact that it was Independence Day. And I thought about the scriptures that I had, and I went, oh, independence. So we're free in Jesus, amen? Redemption is a type of independence or freedom or release. But I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. But anyway, when we talk about redemption, we realize that through Jesus we're saved and we have eternal life. We have that gift. But too often we like we said, we walk by sight and not by faith. And it might sound like I'm repeating myself in some of the statements, but the way my wife told it to me was, just look at it as confirmation. But some of the things that I had heard the Lord say to me to talk about, we've had several guest speakers come in and say some of the very same things. And I was sitting there going, oh, now I got to change this because it'll sound like I'm copying or repeating what they said. No, it's confirmation. So that's what we're going to look at is redemption. And we'll probably hear some of the same scriptures again, but it's confirmation. Thank the Lord for confirmation. Yes, we're saved. And we're filled with the Holy Ghost, some of us. And we say we have Christ living in us, but we still walk around. And I'm talking about me, so I don't want nobody saying, well, why are you talking about me? I'm going to talk about me today, okay? I would walk around like this. Well, no joy, no happiness. Why? Because I forgot about something. I forgot about the benefits of redemption. There are a lot of benefits. There are a lot of benefits of redemption in the Bible. I'm only going to talk about a few of them because Pastor likes for us to be to the point, get it done, sit down. But even more importantly, yeah, I have to say what God says, not what I want to say. Because if I say what I want to say, you're not going to get anything out of it anyway. And all I'll get is a big head, and it's not about that. Redemption brings us back to God, the first thing that redemption does, or gives us reconciliation or restoration. Redemption gives us the truth of God's word, or the truth about certain circumstances. Redemption has given us peace. Redemption has given us healing. Redemption has given us freedom, which we touched on just a little bit ago about this being Independence Weekend. And redemption gives us wisdom and righteousness. It also gives us blessings. Redemption also gives us authority in Christ Jesus. Notice I said in Christ Jesus, not in Jesus Christ. I'll explain that a little bit later. But some people say it's the same. You know, it's just a matter of how you're looking at it. Again, Psalms 107, verse 2. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. The word redeemed means to be bought. In order to be redeemed, you have to have a Redeemer. And we know that Jesus is our Redeemer. And the Hebrew word for Redeemer is Goel, G-O-E-L. In other words, one charged with the duty of restoring the rights of another and avenging his wrongs. One charged with the duty of restoring the rights of another and avenging his wrongs. The first example of redemption can be found in Genesis, well, maybe the second, actually. Because I'm going to talk, just bring up Cain and Abel. Genesis chapter 4, the story of Cain and Abel. Everybody knows who the parents of Cain and Abel was, right? Adam and Steve? No, Adam and Eve. Genesis 4, verse 1. Now Adam knew Eve's wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, and said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. Then she bore again, this time his brother, Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. And Abel also brought the firstborn of his flock of their fat. And the Lord had respect to Abel's offering, but he did not respect Cain's offering. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. And a while ago, I told you, I had a tendency to walk around like, woe is me. You know, my countenance was falling. Well, this story of redemption, we'll go a little further. Verse 6 says, the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why is your countenance fallen? And the Lord asked the question, said, if you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not well, sin lies at the door. So if you do what God says to do, whether you reap a reward, if you will, from it or not, it's good to keep doing good. Amen? Amen. So, after a process of time, Cain killed Abel. And the Lord asked, what have you done? And the voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength in you. A fugitive and a vagabond shall you be on the earth. And Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Surely you have driven me out this day from the face of the ground. I shall be hidden from your face. And he was complaining, I'm going to be driven from you. But more, worse than that, if you will, anybody that sees me is going to kill me. So the Lord said, if whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken against him. Sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anybody find him to kill him. That's one form of redemption, because Cain killed Abel. He didn't have to. He let jealousy take over. Getting back to the word redemption or redeem, to buy back. For example, if you have a nice piece of jewelry and you take it to a pawn shop, you give it to the pawnbroker and he gives you X amount of dollars. Well, that jewelry is still yours. But you relinquish it to the pawnbroker. It's his until you pay him back the money you borrowed, plus the penalty fee or interest that goes along with that. You can't redeem your property until you pay it back. Redeem, to buy back. Well, Jesus redeemed you and I. He paid the price or the ransom and penalty fee for our sins. Therefore, he redeemed us, you and I, from the curse of the law. The law, the first five books of the Old Testament, has some very strict guidelines. And there's no way that you and I in the natural can observe and keep each and every one of those laws. There's just no way. And according to the Old Testament law, if you broke one of the laws, you had to pay a penalty. You had to bring sin offerings. There's various types of sin offerings listed. And, you keep sinning, eventually you're going to be broke. If you had a herd of cattle and you sinned for 2 or 3 years straight and you had to give a sacrifice, eventually you're going to run out of cattle. What are you going to do then? You know, you are you willing to lay yourself on the altar of sacrifice? Deuteronomy 7 verse 8 says, "But because the Lord loved you and me, and because he would keep the oath which he has sworn to your fathers, has the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondsmen from the hand of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt." And of course, we know this is talking about the children of Israel, but we can apply this to our lives today because Egypt represents sin or bondage. Some of us were in sin, and some of us were in bondage. You might not have been sinning, but you were in bondage to a particular habit or a lifestyle. And from that, we have been redeemed. Even so, we have redemption, we have salvation, but we still face life's challenges. And too often, I allow circumstances in my life to overwhelm me and distract me and discourage me. So you can take the same words I'm saying and apply it to yourself. Like I said, I don't want nobody to think I'm preaching to you. Okay? I'm just sharing some encouragement. Too often, I allow certain circumstances to dictate how I act and respond. And the only thing that does is make me feel even worse. Why? Because I have not put my faith and trust in the one who's redeemed me, and that's Jesus Christ. We don't know what to expect next. For some of us, it's one test after another, one trial after another, one circumstance after another, you know, one bad turn after another, if you will. You know, we buy a car, it breaks down. You go buy another car, it breaks down. You buy another car, it breaks down, and you're like, well, I might as well just go buy a bicycle, and it breaks down. We all too often react the wrong way instead of responding with what God says, because we've been walking by sight and not by faith, instead of walking by faith, not by sight. Trials and tests too often deceive us into believing the lies of the devil. Well, if my car keeps breaking down, it must mean I'm not meant to have a car. I can always catch the bus. Well, you get on the bus and the bus breaks down. What you gonna do then? John 10:10 says that the thief comes not but for to steal, kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said, "I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." Deception is nothing but a lie. If we don't know the truth about a situation or a circumstance, and we listen to the deceptiveness of it instead, then we're listening to a lie. And lies are from the devil. The devil, according to John 8:44, is the father of it. So we should turn our focus and attention on the one who came to give life, and life more abundantly, Christ Jesus. Verse 11 of John 10 says that Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep." Another reason for deception or lack of knowledge is found in Hosea 4 verse 6. Hosea 4:6 basically says that my people perish for a lack of knowledge. But the reason we perish for lack of knowledge is because we haven't sought after knowledge. For a long time, I would quote that scripture. I would quote it incorrectly. I would say, Hosea 4:6 says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. But there's a whole lot, there's more. When I finally realized that we perish for lack of knowledge because we haven't sought knowledge. You know, there's a little bit more to that scripture, and we don't often hear the whole scripture. And in that, we can be deceived. We have people come and minister the word, they minister out of context, or they give a quote truth that they understand that maybe the general public or, you know, the general body of Christ as a whole does not understand yet. Maybe they're not ready for it, so they should basically not give that revelation, quote unquote. Hosea 4:6, and the complete verse says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, thou says, I will reject you, and you shall be no priest to me, seeing you have forgotten the law of your God. I will also forget your children. So this is a serious promise that, you know, if we reject knowledge, God is going to reject us, and he'll forget our children. We want our children to be blessed. Amen. We should not allow deception to take over. We have to take advantage of the benefits of redemption that Father God gave us through Christ Jesus. Like I said before, discouragement is a type of deception. Another type of deception is our feelings of rejection. Like, nobody likes me. Nobody wants to talk to me. Nobody wants to be around me. You know, is something wrong with my deodorant? You know, did I, you know, am I using the wrong toothpaste? You know, I know it sounds silly, but it's the truth. There are a lot of people that are very self-conscious about things like that, and they walk around, you know, saying nobody wants to, whatever, be around me, or et cetera, because of, you know, whatever you want to fill in the blank with. And it's all a lie. It could be that maybe your personality is different than the other person. They don't know how to approach you. You know, you may be, maybe your countenance says, I'm full of confidence, I'm full of faith. And a person who may be struggling says, well, you know, that person's arrogant. Well, not necessarily. They may be waiting for you to come and talk to them so they can build you up and encourage you so that your countenance can change, so you can be confident in yourself and not have the attitude that they think they're better than you are, or have an air of superiority. Low self-esteem is a deception. This country is known for its high level of suicide, and all of that, a lot of that is because of low self-esteem, especially amongst our teenagers. You know, we have these knuckleheads in school called bullies. You know, they antagonize, quote, the weaker child, or the child that knows how to control themselves. They're acting a fool, and they want that child to act out like they're acting out. So they do silly stuff and antagonize and pick on the child, and, you know, they walk around with, quote, low self-esteem. They don't know how to handle it, and they go and kill themselves. The main reason for this is we haven't been taught how to let patience have her perfect work. James 1 verse 2 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into different or diverse temptations. The King James uses the word diverse, which is the same word as different, or various temptations. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect or complete and entire, wanting nothing. When your faith is strong in Jesus, nothing can touch you. When your faith is strong in Jesus, no circumstance can affect how you act or respond. Why? Because you're letting the Holy Spirit lead, guide, and direct your actions and your words, so that if you're placed in a situation that requires a stern rebuke, you'll give that stern rebuke, but you'll give it in love. Or if you need to serve someone, you'll serve someone with the right attitude and right motive, not with a, well, I did this for you, you got to do something for me in return. You know, you'll have the right focus, the right perspective. Verse 5 says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. If you want to ask God for one thing, let it be wisdom. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. In other words, when we ask God for faith or wisdom, when we ask God for wisdom, we should ask him in faith and thank him in faith that we have received the wisdom that he's given. But you say, Lord, I'll thank you for giving me wisdom. And then immediately you say, well, I don't know what to do about, well, you just canceled that prayer out, that request out, because you're wavering. You're not standing firm in faith. Another scripture that comes to mind is, how long would you halt between two opinions? If God is God, serve God. If the devil is God, then serve the devil. You know, don't waver between the two. Stand firm in your faith in Jesus. Amen. John 16:33, Jesus said, these things have I spoken unto you, that you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world. We should put our total trust in Jesus Christ. John 17:1 says, these words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may also glorify you. Because you have given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And thankfully we can say, boldly that we are saved and we have the gift of salvation and eternal life through and by Jesus because of what he did on the cross. And that in itself is reason enough to be happy and excited. You know, you can be Donald Trump. You can have Donald Trump's money and the property that he owns or that his company owns. But if you don't have Jesus Christ in the center of your life, you will be one miserable man or woman, as it were. Remind yourself that you are bought with a price. And that price, or that ransom fee, that penalty fee, was the blood of Jesus. How many of you heard the phrase that Jesus lives in my heart? We all hear that, right? Well, this happened to me a few years ago when we first moved to the area. I had a car that broke down. So what is it with him and cars breaking down? That's one of the tests that applied to me. Anyway, my car broke down, so I had to use public transportation to get to and from work. Even at that, I still had to walk a distance to my job. So one morning, it was about 32 degrees outside, and I was walking from the bus stop to the job, and I was complaining. Notice I said I was complaining. Lord, you know, I'm tired of walking in the cold. I'm tired of having to catch the bus. I need a car, la 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 la. What am I supposed to do? Holy Spirit said, is there not a king in you? I went, huh? No, my last name's, no, I know your last name's King, but is there not a king in you? I said, what do you mean, Lord? You say that you're my son. And that my son lives in you, right? I said, yeah, Jesus is my Lord and Savior. He lives in my heart. If the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, lives in your heart, where's your counselor? Or is your counselor dead? And I was like, okay, Lord, I don't know, what are you trying to say? So immediately he said, Micah 4:9. This is one of the few times that the Lord has spoken audibly to me and given me a direct scripture to look up. And when I did, as I got the word, I looked it up, Micah 4:9. Why dost thou cry out aloud? The King James says, is there no king in thee? Is thy counselor perished? For pangs have taken thee as a woman in travail. Talk about a gentle rebuke. In other words, if the King of Kings resides in our heart, there's no way we should be walking around with our head hung down and depressed because things aren't going the way we want them to go. I mean, you're sitting there smiling in your situation. I wasn't. I was having a pity party. You thought Elijah had a pity party? No, I was having a big time pity party. So what do we do when we don't know what to do? We remember the benefits of redemption. We remember that God is in control. Notice that God is in control, not you and I. Because Genesis 1:1, it says, in the beginning, God. It doesn't say in the beginning, Roger or Terry or Eve. John 1:1 even says, in the beginning was the Word. It didn't say in the beginning was Pastor Paul Santos. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Point being is, we're not in control. On our own, we are not in control. We are just pawns on the chessboard, if you will. We need to learn to develop an attitude of thanksgiving, praise, and worship. And, you know, we go back to James, where it says, let patience have a perfect word. The only way that's going to happen is when you get to the point where, when I get off the bus and it's 32 degrees, Lord, I thank you that I got a job to walk to, even if it is 32 degrees outside. Because when I get there, it's warm. And I could sit down. I had a job that I could sit down. The phone rang every now and then, and I could sit there and read his word. I was blessed in the fact that, yeah, it was cold outside, but when I got there, It was nice and warm, and I could focus on him. I could praise him because my car was on the way. Lord, I thank you that I'm able to have money to catch the bus, to get to work, to make the money I need to buy the car. Tax season came around. Lord, I thank you. I praise you that I have a job, that my income tax is going to be filed. I don't owe the IRS this year. I'm getting a refund. I worship you, Lord, because when I get my refund, I'm going to buy a car. You're going to direct me to the car to buy. And I thank you, Lord, and I praise you, Lord, for that car. You're going to show me the right car. Lo and behold, tax time came around. My wife did the paperwork. We got a nice refund. Went and got a car. It was the one that the Lord told us to get. And we had that car for maybe 3 or 4 years. And then the Lord one day said, give it to a neighbor. And that's what we did. And today that car is somewhere around. We don't know. But the point being is I had to change my attitude. You know, the more I said, I'm tired of walking, it's cold, well, guess what? I was going to take another lap, as they say, and keep walking in the cold. Encourage yourself in the Lord. God's word never changes. His word lasts forever. Search the scriptures and find God's promises for you. And that's something that I thank God for Pastor Paul instilling in us to learn and memorize scripture. Because it is real important to learn and memorize scriptures that apply to our lives. For so long, you know, we've gone without feasting on the Word of God that certain things come up and like, you know, here we go again. What next? No, there are promises in the Word of God that we can stand on so that when the enemy does come in, quote, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will come and raise a standard. For example, Jeremiah 29:11. I think everybody knows that one. But the Lord says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you an expected end, or an expected hope, one version says. Psalm 1:3, and you shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth its fruit in season. So as we stand firm in God's word, we eventually produce fruit. Jeremiah 17:7, blesses the man that trusts in the Lord and whose hope the Lord is. I can't trust in my wife's faith. I can't trust in Pastor Paul's faith, or Pastor Clyde, or Brother Al's faith, or even the sisters of faith. I can't put my trust in my job. I could go to work tomorrow and be told, okay, we don't need your services anymore. Then what? You know, I can't put my trust in my job. I guess I bring that up because a few weeks ago, I really like what I do. It's not the most glamorous job in the world. However, it's not the worst job I've ever had. I would rather do what I'm doing now than dig ditch. And I've done my share of ditch digging. But I'm not above digging ditches. But I say that to say this. I really enjoy what I do, and the Lord prompted me, you need to let your job go. He didn't say quit and resign your job. Let your job go. In other words, I was putting more emphasis and priority on my job than I was on him. I can still work my job and live by faith and work that job, but he should still be my supply, my source, and my goal or my measure that I live by, not my job. So what? I don't have a Mercedes Benz. I have a Ford Focus. Guess what? A Mercedes and a Ford, they do the same thing. If the battery dies in the Mercedes, guess what? You ain't going nowhere. Reading and memorizing the Word of God is another, based on what we just said, you know, learning certain scriptures or promises that pertain to your life, or find out what God says about your situation. You know, I've heard it once said that we should all take the time to find what God says for our life, because there's a God said for your life and mine. Develop a prayer life. Oh, well, I don't like to pray because I don't know what to say. Well, you got a book. This one's a little thin. Some of us have one that's a little thicker. And some of us have one that's even thicker. And if we would all go blow the dust off of them, we can find out what God's word says about certain situations. And we can learn how to pray by praying God's word, because actually we can take the word of God and give it back to God. That's a form of prayer. And then the Holy Spirit will pray through you. Regular attendance in church, Bible study, and then some churches have small group meetings. Well, we have small group meetings here as well. The women get together on Saturday mornings to pray, and the men fellowship every other Saturday. It's a type of small group. Praying in the Spirit for those that are Spirit-filled with the evidence of praying, speaking in tongues. Testifying and witnessing are other ways that we can encourage ourselves and by encouraging others. You know, thinking about praise and worship, the pastor touched on the scripture a few nights ago in talking about the book of Revelation, where the angels, there's an angel called Seraphim, and their responsibility is to stand around the throne of God, and they worship the Father. And the only thing, I'll read the scripture, Isaiah 6, verse 3, I'll start at verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And it stood, above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain, or with two, he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he did fly. One cried unto another and said, Brother Clyde, I'm going to say holy, and you say holy back, please. This is what this is saying. One cried to another, holy, holy, holy. I want some water. Holy. The angel can't say, I want water. The angel says it, holy, back and forth, holy, holy. So when God hears us praise and worship him, and we stand up and we say holy, I can imagine the Father say, y'all hold on a minute. Y'all just take a break. I want to hear my children say, holy, holy. You know, he wants to enjoy our praise and worship to him. It's like, y'all hold on. Y'all already see. Hold on. I want to hear them. You know, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty, the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Where gross darkness abounds, his glory and grace much more abound. Amen. We should let the light of Jesus shine. We're not the light, but we are to carry the light. My wife was talking about a situation recently, and I said, we've got to remember, we are carriers of the glory of God, or the light of God. You know, we carry Jesus with us where we go. So carry the glory in there with you. Let the glory be manifested. And lo and behold, that's what happened. John 1:6 says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. And the same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, referring to Jesus Christ, that all men through him might believe. Now, again, I said, we carry the light. We're not the light. Verse 8 says, he was not the light, but he was sent to bear witness of that light. So our responsibility is to bear witness of Jesus Christ who lives in us. Speak the word of God in faith. We all know that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Without faith, the Bible says that it is impossible to please God. And the only way we can grow in faith is to abide in the word of God, and abide in Christ. And when we think about the word abide, one way of looking at it is to abide, or to dwell, or to set up camp, to rest. John 15:7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. The only way that's going to happen is abiding and spending time in the presence of God. First Kings 8:13, the scripture says, I have surely built thee a house to dwell in, a settled place for thee to abide in forever. After abiding and resting in the things of God, we need to learn to rise up. We need to learn to take a stand in faith, and out to stand in faith and by faith on the promises of God in our circumstances in our life. For example, 2 Kings 7, verse 3, you know the story of the four lepers men. 17:3, and there were four leprous men at the entering of the gate that said one to another, why sit we here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, then the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit still here, we die also. Now therefore come and let us fall into the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall die. In other words, if we stay here, there's a possibility we're going to die. If we go into the city, we might be able to eat for a little bit, but still, you know, we might die, but we don't necessarily know. But if we wait, the Syrians are going to come and kill us anyway. If we sit around and do nothing, nothing plus nothing equals. So they rose up. Verse 5 says they rose up, and so they went. And you can read in your own time, read the rest of the story, and we know that they did not die. It was like the four lepers said, what do we do? If we stay here, we die. You know, what do we do now? I mean, we don't have any other choice. Keep doing good things. Continue living by our faith. Remember now, we do have redemption in God. The promises or the benefits of redemption, they bring us back to God, they restore us or reconciles us, if you will. Redemption has given us the truth. John 8:32. Redemption has given us salvation. Everybody knows John 3:16. Redemption has given us peace. If you read Numbers chapter 7, you'll see the law concerning giving peace offerings. Redemption has given us healing. Isaiah 53 verses 3 through 6. That's everybody quotes that one all the time. You know, surely has borne our griefs. His, you know, by his stripes we're healed. Redemption has given us freedom. Romans 3:24. Romans 8:1-2. We've already quoted, read this one. Psalm 107:2. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Redemption has given us wisdom and righteousness. Romans 8:10-11. Redemption has given us blessings. You know, we talked about being able to purchase a car. That's a blessing. You know, it's a blessing to be able to come and gather here and worship the Lord the way we do. In other parts of the world, they have to do it in secret, if at all. You know, it's a blessing to be able to get in a car and go down the street and, you know, if somebody is in need of help, we can help them. We don't have to wait for the government to come by and help them. It's a blessing that if we can't help them, the government is available to help them. And for that matter, even us, because there might be times in some of our lives that we've had to go to the government for various types of help. And there's nothing wrong with that. But the one thing, the primary thing that I want to leave with you is the last benefit of redemption that the Lord gave me was authority in Christ Jesus. Before the cross, Jesus gave his authority to the disciples. He said, in my name you shall, and fill in the blanks. But after the cross, by receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit, we can stand as if we are in the place of Christ. I didn't say we were or are Christ. We stand in his place. We don't have to wait and say, Jesus, come down here and take care of this. He's given us the authority to speak to the mountain and tell it to move. We can speak healing and deliverance. We have we were given the authority of Jesus. Now we have authority in Jesus. And again, I'm reminded of Michael 4:9. Is there no king in you? The king is residing in us. So let's let the king operate the way he wants to operate. One of the things that I've been asking the Lord to help me make my prayer is Romans 8:38. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any creature or any person shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Why? Because if I allow these things to come against me and to take me out of my right relationship with Christ, then I forfeit the benefits of redemption. I forfeit my right to have authority in Christ. I forfeit the blessings. I forfeit being reconciled to God. I forfeit the truth, peace, and healing. Final thought about having the authority of Jesus. When standing in the authority of Jesus, there's a scripture, a story in 2 Kings 18, where Hezekiah was encouraging the people, and he took a stand. I'll just read it. 18 verse 1 through 4. Now it came to pass in the third year of Hosea, son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. 25 years old was he when he began to reign, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Abi, or Abi, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that David his father did. And this is what really stood out to me from the story with Hezekiah. He removed the high places and break the images and cut down the groves and break in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. And you recall, Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt and led them into the wilderness, and they, made this brazen serpent for their healing. When they raised up the brazen serpent, if you had a particular illness, they looked upon it and they received healing. Well, Hezekiah removed the high places, break the images, cut down the groves, broken pieces of the brazen serpent that Moses made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it. In other words, they worshipped it. And it irritated and made Hezekiah so righteously indignant, if you will, that I could picture in my mind, he took that brazen serpent and, now who's that? He broke it. In other words, enough is enough. Nehushtan. In other words, we have to get to a point in our faith walk where we say, enough is enough. The devil is not going to take any more of my joy. He's not going to take any more of my peace. He's not going to take any more of my righteousness, because I'm righteousness. I am the righteousness of Christ Jesus, and he lives in me, and I'm going to serve him. I want to do what he wants me to do, no matter what. Sometimes you have to take a stand. Now, I didn't say you get defensive and fight back, because we don't fight. The battle is the Lord's. But we, even though the scripture says we wrestle, it's like you wrestle an idea or a thought in your mind. That's why they take every thought captive. But we have to come to the point where we say, enough is enough. Devil, I'm not putting up with you anymore. You got to go. I plead the blood of Jesus against you. You have to go. And in my mind, I pictured Jesus on the cross when he said the same words. But he said it a little bit differently. John 19, verse 30. John 19, verse 30. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. In other words, Jesus was raised up like the brazen serpent was raised up. But the brazen serpent couldn't speak. So Hezekiah took the serpent down and broke it and said, Nehushtan. But Jesus, while he was on the cross, stretched out and looked down and said, Nehushtan, it is finished. I know he didn't say Nehushtan, but the point I'm trying to make is he said enough is enough. It's a done deal. I've done all the work that needs to be done. It is finished. It's accomplished. And the other two places that same context is used is Revelation 16, 17, where it says it is done. And in Revelation 21, 6, the same thing says it is done. Jesus is the beginning and the ending. He's the Alpha and Omega. He is the one who is the author and finisher of our faith. And because of Jesus, we can enjoy our benefits of redemption. Lord, we thank you for restoration, reconciliation. We thank you for the truth. We thank you, Lord, for salvation. We thank you, Lord, for peace. We thank you, Lord, for healing. We thank you for our freedom, wisdom, and righteousness. We thank you for blessings, Lord. And we thank you most of all, Lord, for the authority that you have given us in Christ Jesus, Lord. And we just count it a joy and a blessing and an honor, Lord, to be able to say that we are your child and we're your children. And we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.